During the previous video, we discussed the 3S criteria, which include sensitivity, selectivity, and speed. In particular, in this video, we will focus on the speed of the protection system and its potential impacts on the operation of the distributed generators. The main learning objectives will fall under three main questions. Firstly, how will the operation of the distributed generators will be affected by the faults? Secondly, what is the critical clearing time and how is it calculated? Thirdly, what are the differences of the short circuit currents of the distributed generators with and without power electronic interfaces? We discussed that microgrids shall be able to isolate the internal faults using proper protection methods. If the fault is not quickly cleared, then some electrical equipment might be damaged. Also, this delay associated with the protection system may result in the instability of the distributed generators based on the electrical machines. The diesel engines, microturbines, and gas turbines are a number of examples of the distributed generators based on the electrical machines. On the one hand, due to their direct connection to the microgrid, these types of the distributed generators will inject a large amount of the short circuit current. On the other hand, there are other types of the electrical components which are connected to the microgrid through power electronic interfaces. These units typically inject a lower amount of the short circuit current due to the presence of the highly controlled power electronic switches. Note that additional control loops can be added to these units to increase their contribution to the fault current. However, by default, these controllers are not implemented in these units. The electric vehicles, batteries, and full-scale permanent magnet speed generators are the examples of the electrical components using power electronic interfaces. Let's now have a look into the structure of the distributed generation based on the electrical machines. The electrical machine consists of two main parts, the rotor and the stator. The stator of the machine is directly connected to the grid. Through that, the electrical power of the machine is exchanged with the three-phase grid. During the normal operating conditions, there is a balance between the input mechanical power on the left-hand side and the electrical power on the right-hand side. As a result, the speed of the electrical machine remains at its nominal value. The equivalent electrical circuit of the electrical machine can be represented by an AC voltage source with the amplitude voltage E and the phase delta that will be in series with the transient reactance of the machine, X prime. The voltage at the terminal of the machine is shown by U. Taking into account the active power calculations from the first peak, the active power can be calculated based on the amplitude of the internal and terminal voltage of the machine, the rotor angle data, and the transient reactance of the machine. The electrical power, PE, depends on the sign of the rotor angle, as the power versus the rotor angle is shown in the figure. At point A, the input mechanical power, PM, is equal to the electrical power at delta zero during the stable steady state condition before the fault. At point B, we show that the maximum possible electrical power when the value of the sine function is equal to 1. Point C shows another possible operating state at which the mechanical and electrical power have also the same value. However, this is not considered as a feasible state operating point. Now let's consider that a fault occurs at the terminal of the electrical machine during the fault. The value of the terminal voltage U is almost equal to zero. As a result, the electrical power during the fault is equal to zero. During the fault, though the electrical power is zero, the input mechanical power remains constant. This means that all the input mechanical energy will be stored in the rotating mass of the machine, and as a result, the rotor angle starts to increase from delta 0 to delta C. In other words, during the fault period, the rotor is in the accelerating mode, where area A1 represents the amount of the electrical energy stored in the rotor shaft. We assume that at delta C, the fault is clear. When the fault is cleared, the terminal voltage U gains almost its pre-fault value. As a result, the electrical power at this rotor angle is obtained depending on the sign of delta C. If we look at the power versus the rotor angle at delta C, the electrical power has a larger value than the input mechanical power. This means that the machine is injecting more electrical power to the grid compared to its input mechanical power. As a result, the rotor starts to deaccelerate due to the release of its kinetic energy to the grid. In this case, the rotor enters to the deacceleration mode. The area A2 represents the amount of the kinetic energy that is injected back to the electrical grid. Then, what happens if the rotor angle reaches point C? At point C, the rotor enters again from the deacceleration mode to the acceleration mode, because after point C at delta M, the input mechanical power becomes again greater than the electrical power. In this case, the rotor speed steadily increases and the machine becomes unstable. So what is the main equilibrium criterion to keep the stability of these distributed generators based on the electrical machines? It is required that area 2, A2, would be greater than or equal to area A1. In other words, the deacceleration of the rotor in area 2 shall be large enough to cancel out the acceleration of the rotor in the area A1. Otherwise, the rotor angle reaches point C, which is unstable operating mode for the electrical machine. For a specific value of delta C, it is possible that two areas, A1 and A2, have the same value. This value of delta C is called the critical clearing angle. If we solve the equation to have these two areas the same, then we obtain the critical clearing time as a function of the rotor inertia, H, the input mechanical power, Pm, and the angular speed of the nominal frequency, omega 0, and the rotor angle difference between delta C and delta 0. If the fault is cleared after the critical clearing time, Tc, then the machine becomes unstable. Then the question is, how would it be possible to have the smallest possible area for A1 to maintain the stability? The answer is that the fault shall be quickly cleared using the protection relays. This time shall be less than or equal to the critical clearing time. Otherwise, the electrical machine in the microgrid becomes unstable. In the figure, we show the rotor angle of an electrical machine where its critical clearing time is equal to 86 milliseconds, and the fault is applied at the time equal to zero. If the fault clearing time is below the critical value, for instance at 70 milliseconds, then the electrical machine remains stable. If the fault clearing time is above the critical value, for instance at 87 milliseconds, then the electrical machine becomes unstable, where the rotor angle gains a very large value. If the critical clearing time is equal to the critical value of 86 milliseconds, then the machine is at the stability border. Note that the time current tripping curve of the protection devices, like protection relays, shall be carefully set below this critical clearing time. In other words, the speed of these relays shall be adjusted in microgrids in such a way that the possible instabilities associated with the distributed generators based on the electrical machines will be avoided. Let's now have a look into the stator current during the fault. As it can be seen in the figure on the right, the stator current includes both AC and DC components, which we'll formulate in the next videos. On the one hand, the exponential decay, DC decay component is shown in the red curve. On the other hand, the AC component consisting of three parts, namely the joint subtransient period, the transient period, and the steady state period are shown in blue. As it is shown, the value of the current can reach very high values, for instance, up to 6 times of the nominal current. Note that these high values of the current help detect the fault faster by the protection devices in AC microgrids. So far, we discussed about the behavior of the directly connected distributed generators based on electrical machines during the faults. But what about the behavior of the electrical components during the faults that are connected to the microgrid using the power electronic interfaces? In fact, the behavior of these types of electrical components highly depends on the type of their internal power and current controllers. However, in general, these units inject a low amount of the fault current, for instance, around 1.2 up to 1.5 times of the nominal current. With the ever-increasing number of the electrical components using power electronic interfaces, the value of the fault current in microgrids will become lower. This makes the detection of the fault more difficult in microgrids. In the figure, at the time equal to 15 milliseconds, the fault is applied where the deviation of the fault current is from 1 to 1.5 times of the nominal value. Note that the current of each phase, A, B, or C, might be different depending on the type of the fault. For instance, these are obviously totally different from the single phase to ground faults to the three phase faults. During the next videos, we will calculate the fault current for different types of the faults in AC and DC microgrids. In summary, we addressed the behavior of two types of distributed generators with and without the power electronic interfaces. We discussed that the distributed generators based on the electrical machines will become unstable if the fault clearing time is greater than the critical clearing time. Moreover, we compared the fault current of these two types of the electrical components. The large contribution of the electrical machines to the fault current facilitates the detection of the fault, though the low contribution of the components using power electronic interfaces will make it difficult to detect the fault in microgrids.